All of us have important things we have to remember. Think about all of the information you need to pass the driver's license exam. If you're a nurse, it's scary how much you need to know to pass the boards. If you've decided to memorize and recite your vows when you get married, better not forget those. Your kids' birthdays, your kids' names, your own anniversary. Some of these could be really important. We figure out a way to remember and recall what we need and what is important to us. The Jewish people were commanded to remember a number of things. That they were slaves in Egypt. That God miraculously delivered them from Pharaoh. That God promised to settle and secure them in their own land. And that he established a sacred covenant with them. Biblical remembrance is never simply a recollection of facts regarding past events. To remember involves a vivid and graphic reflection on an event, often using tokens or objects to reenact the episode being remembered. One of the more prominent commands for remembrance in the Old Testament centers on the celebration of the Passover, when God spared the Jewish people but struck down the firstborn of Egypt. The Hebrews sacrificed a lamb, spread its blood on the sides and top of the frames of their doors, so that the angel of death would pass over them. Exodus 12:14 says, "This day, the celebration of the Passover, shall be for you a memorial day, and you shall keep it as a feast to the Lord throughout your generations, as a statute forever. You shall keep it as a feast." But the Jewish people neglected to keep the Passover, just as they did much of the Mosaic covenant. We know that for about 700 years between Joshua and Josiah, the Passover was not remembered or celebrated in any regular, widespread way. Neglecting the Passover celebration contributed to the Jewish people drifting far from God. Christians must remember several things not unlike the Jewish people. But maybe the most familiar remember in all of the Bible is connected to communion. In the Gospels and in 1 Corinthians, when we partake of the elements of the Lord's Supper, Jesus said, "Do this in remembrance of me." There is more here than initially meets the eye. All throughout the Gospels, the writers are careful to connect Jesus with the Old Testament Passover lamb. John the Baptist, in John chapter 1, says that Jesus is the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. In Exodus 12, the Passover lamb could not have broken a bone. In John 19, we are told that Jesus' bones were not broken, just like the Passover lamb. The suffering servant of Isaiah 53, who will atone for his people, is silent, like a lamb being led to a slaughter. So also, Jesus remained silent through almost all of his trial and crucifixion. When we come to the Lord's table, we enter into a time of remembrance as we ponder the Lamb of God who sheds his blood to turn away God's wrath, like the blood of the Passover lamb in Egypt. It is our responsibility to participate in the Lord's table using the tokens of his sacrificial death, the bread and the cup. To remember that Jesus in his death gave his body for us. To remember Jesus who died of exsanguination, who bled out for us to atone for our sins, whose blood is applied to us by the Father so his judgment passes over us. We do this in remembrance of him.
I remember the heights from which I have fallen. I remember my tears, all the hunger and longing. I remember of your spirit upon me, and now I'm moved with your heart.
I'm returning to my first love. So here is my heart. Come and wound me with longing. Let your refiner's fire come and have its way fully. Till righteousness falls like a flood from within me. Till the zeal of the Lord comes.
What we have gathered to celebrate this weekend is a climactic moment in the biblical story of salvation. These are holy moments before us right now. Tonight, we're going to remember our Lord Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God, who takes away our sins, the one sent from the Father, who gave his life in sacrificial love for you and for me. Throughout our next hour together, we're going to remember our Lord, not simply a recollection of facts, but a vivid reflection on the profound and unfathomable depths of God's love for us in Jesus. In remembrance, we will be invited to reflect. Behold again the events and the sacrifice of our Savior in our place, on our behalf. And in remembrance, we repent. We bring our whole selves before the Lord in humility, acknowledging the authority of Jesus as Lord in our own lives, uncovering the hidden places, and turning from any sin that we may be holding on to. And in remembrance, we receive. Because of Jesus's payment of our debt, we are assured that our sins are forgiven. When we turn to the Lord, we have communion with him and with each other. And finally, in remembrance, we respond. The sacrificial love displayed at the cross evokes a response. Such love given on our behalf does not leave the recipient unchanged. Sent out as the renewed people of God, we realize that the cross is not only an act on our behalf, but also the model of the selfless way of life that Jesus leads us into. And when Sunday comes and harvest is coming, we will rejoice because the death of Jesus leads to the overflowing life of God. God raised Jesus from the dead, vindicating him as the Son of God and giving him all authority in heaven and earth. So restoration, renewal, healing, redemption, the defeat of the powers of evil, and the certain coming of the new creation are all woven into and carried by the resurrection of the victorious King, Jesus Christ. Those who are in Jesus, the Messiah, participate in his resurrection life, both now and in the age to come, experiencing the joy of being brought from death to life, being adopted into the family of God, being empowered by the Holy Spirit, and living for the King and his kingdom. So as we enter in and reflect, let us do so how thousands have done by singing about the one who we have gathered for, the Son of Man, the man of suffering, the man of sorrows, harvest. Let's stand.
Take this bread, take this wine as a symbol of the price for any who believe. By your mercy we come to your table. By your grace you are making us faithful. Lord, we remember.
Matthew 27, verses 20 through 50. Now the chief priests and the elders persuaded the crowd to ask for Barabbas and destroy Jesus. The governor again said to them, "Which of the two do you want me to release for you?" And they said, "Barabbas." Pilate said to them, "Then what shall I do with Jesus, who is called Christ?" They all said, "Let him be crucified." And he said, "Why? What evil has he done?" But they shouted all the more, "Let him be crucified." So when Pilate saw that he was gaining nothing, but rather that a riot was beginning, he took water and washed his hands before the crowd, saying, "I am innocent of this man's blood. See to it yourselves." And all the people answered, "His blood be on us and on our children." Then he released for them Barabbas, and having scourged Jesus, delivered him to be crucified. Then the soldiers of the governor took Jesus into the governor's headquarters, and they gathered the whole battalion before him. And they stripped him and put a scarlet robe on him. And twisting together a crown of thorns, they put it on his head and put a reed in his right hand. And kneeling before him, they mocked him, saying, "Hail, King of the Jews." And they spit on him and took the reed and struck him on the head. And when they had mocked him, they stripped him of the robe and put his own clothes on him and led him away to crucify him. As they went out, they found a man of Cyrene, Simon by name. They compelled this man to carry his cross. And when they came to the place called Golgotha, which means place of a skull, they offered him wine to drink mixed with gall. But when he tasted it, he would not drink it. And when they had crucified him, they divided his garments among them by casting lots. Then they sat down and kept watch over him there. And over his head, they put the charge against him, which read, "This is Jesus, the King of the Jews." Then two robbers were crucified with him, one on the right and one on the left. And those who passed by derided him, wagging their heads and saying, "You who would destroy the temple and rebuild it in 3 days, save yourself. If you are the Son of God, come down from the cross." So also the chief priests with the scribes and elders mocked him, saying, "He saved others. He cannot save himself. He is the King of Israel. Let him come down now from the cross, and we will believe in him. He trusts in God. Let God deliver him now, if he desires him. For he said, 'I am the Son of God.'" And the robbers who were crucified with him also reviled him in the same way. Now from the sixth hour, there was darkness over all the land until the ninth hour. And about the ninth hour, Jesus cried out with a loud voice, saying, "Eli, Eli, lema sabachthani?" That is, my God, why have you forsaken me?" And some of the bystanders hearing it said, "This man is calling for Elijah." And one of them at once ran and took a sponge, filled it with sour wine, and put it on a reed and gave it to him to drink. But the others said, "Wait, let us see whether Elijah will come to save him." And Jesus cried out again in a loud voice and yielded up his spirit.
Repentance, metanoia, defined as a change of mind, to leave behind sin inside, to deny pride and align with the most divine, to turn away from our evil ways and return to the only way, to our Savior each and every day. Lord, we pray. Your word says that your kindness leads to it. You desire everyone to come to it. Baptism should follow it. Our sins will be wiped out after it. Angels rejoice in the presence of God because of it. And you call all sinners to it, repentance. But repentance requires darkness to be brought to light. So, what is it that you keep in the dark? What is it that lives deep in your heart that you need to depart, taking root like growing weeds in a garden? It's holding you back and keeping you parked, but you leave it in the back seat of the car. Because in order to repent, we must first face what we're repenting of. It requires us to expose our ugliness, what we really despise, to uncover the things we keep buried inside, where our sinful nature resides, hidden like precious treasure. It begins to creep up like rising blood pressure. And that's when we push it down further than ever. If I can just fly over it, maybe it'll wane and diminish. But the reality is that it just decays like a sickness, where it only festers in the bitter cold, where bitter grows and it weighs heavy on my wicked soul, holding me down like bricks for toes. See, it's not worth the price of admission, no matter how many tickets sold. So what is it that you keep in the dark, that you need to turn away from and go back to the start? See, repentance is continual, not just a one-time purchase. Yes, we were saved at conversion, but we're still people not perfect. We all fall like a slippery surface, but it's how we get back up and continue our purpose. Because we all have wicked ways, it's just hereditary. So we must ask forgiveness every month, day, hour, and every minute if necessary. What is it that you keep in the dark? And here we are now as we zero in on the cross. Good Friday puts our sin on display. Don't look away, nah, see what you caused. Our sins hang in the air as they lay bare. I said, don't look away, but stay there and feel the totality of the brutality, his disfigured anatomy, and the gravity as we remember. We're reminded of our depravity. That's the mentality from which repentance is birthed. And whatever we've kept in the dark, we now stare in the face. We leave it all behind and turn away from the things that put them there in the first place. That's why Good Friday drives us to repent. So don't relent. Here's your chance. Don't miss it. Have you figured it out yet? What is it that you need and forgiven? What is it that you need to unearth that's been kept in the dirt? Maybe it's been causing you hurt, or it's got you doubting your worth, or worse, maybe it's created your hearse. Just tell them what it is. Confess it, then let it go. Don't just say the words, but let your actions show that you're leaving it in the rear view so you can get a clear view. God, I want to hear you, so I'm turning from my sins and running to be near you. And that's why repentance must begin in the heart. So, what is it that you keep in the dark?
In a moment, we will come to the Lord together and offer prayers of repentance. So please take a moment of silence right where you are to quiet your mind and center your heart. Come, Holy Spirit. Read this aloud together. There is so much lost in this world, O Lord, so much that aches and groans and shivers. For want of redemption, so much that seems dislocated, upended, desecrated, unhinged, even in our own hearts. Is it any wonder we should weep sometimes without knowing why? Even in our own hearts, we bear the mark of all that is broken. For we fail to love you in our thoughts, actions, and desires, or love our neighbor as ourselves. What is more, O God, I have hidden myself in shadows, seeking to avoid your face. I have drawn away from the sound of your voice, fearful of what you might speak. Fearful of what obedience might require. I have sinned, O Father. Grant me courage now to bring my faults before you into the light.
Lord, hear my prayer. Lord, hear my prayer. When I call, answer me. me.
Proverbs 28:13 says, "The one who conceals his sins will not prosper, but whoever confesses and renounces them will find mercy." So offer silently now a specific confession to God of the wrongs that you have done. Let's do that right now. Let's read this out loud together. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and righteous to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Restore of all things, redeem the damage I have done. Restore, remake, rekindle, rebuild, heal, comfort, and repair. Knit together that which I have rent. Embrace me again to life and right standing with you, O God, and to the fellowship of love and compassion that is your church. I am always, every moment, in need of you.
We're going to go into a time of communion now. So why don't you gather the elements that you've prepared for this moment? Communion is for those who have trusted Jesus Christ as their Savior. If you haven't done that, please don't turn away from this moment, but instead choose to listen as I explain what he did that night in the upper room and the significance of what it means for us and for you. There are several places in Scripture where we are encouraged to remember, but the commandment from Jesus spoken on the night that he was betrayed stands out from all the rest. When gathered at the table in the upper room, at the Jewish Passover meal, surrounded by friends, and even friends who would abandon him, Jesus says, "Do this in remembrance of me." Here we see Jesus commemorating, observing and remembering what God has done while simultaneously revealing what God is doing and will do. Just as the blood of the Passover lamb covered the doorposts of the people of Israel, so the blood of Jesus covers the sins of those who put their trust in him. On the night leading to the cross, Jesus proclaims a new event in God's salvation. One that fulfills the meaning of the annual Passover meal they were celebrating together. One that brought freedom, not just from the physical slavery of oppression to an empire, but freedom from spiritual slavery to sin death and the powers of darkness. As Peter reflects in 1 Peter 2, verse 24, he himself bore our sins in his body on the tree, so that having died to sins, we might live for righteousness. By his wounds, you have been healed. Or as Romans 8, verse 1 says so beautifully, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, because the law of the Spirit of life has set you free from the law of sin and death. Not only does this act of remembrance look back on God's past deliverance, but also affirms a confidence that God will keep future promises as well. In that moment, Jesus and his disciples were not in a season of peace. And yet here, their trusted teacher is offering them just this, to partake with him in a ceremony of celebration and rest. So they trust him, and we should too. So they took the bread and the cup in their hands, as we do now. They held each element as you do and pondered, will he bring salvation? Will he bring deliverance? Their eyes could not see how this could be so. Their eyes did not see the coming betrayal, the trials, the death of their king. Their eyes could not anticipate the fear and disappointment that they would undergo. But Jesus did. So he walked the road of suffering. He carried the weight of our sins. He stood accused and convicted of the wrongs that we've done. He carried the cross that was meant for us, spilled the blood that should have been ours, and had his body broken so that we could be saved. Jesus made the sacrifice that we now remember. We can so often find ourselves living in the Saturday, the no man's land between questions and answers, with a mixture of faith and despair. But as much as we remember the cost, let me remind you, we will rejoice in the outcome. There is hope, and his name is Jesus, and the blood he shed was for all who believe in him. And so now we remember that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it, and he said, this is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. So let's eat together. In the same way also, he took the cup after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. Let's drink together. He says, for as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.
Take the bread of life, broken for all my sin. Your body crucified to make me whole again. I will recall the sinners in for your new covenant. lights reach from the depths, as far as east is from the west. So far, your grace has carried me until I see you face to face. Until at last I've won my race. Remind me you're not finished yet. Hallelujah. 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 I live in
So how do we respond tonight? In this last hour, you were invited to reflect. Reflect on the suffering and death of Jesus Christ, the promised Messiah on your behalf. Jesus in your place. Jesus who willingly laid down his perfect life for you, for me, for us. He faced denial from a friend. He was unfairly accused and beaten and mocked and scorned and ultimately killed by hanging on a criminal's cross for wrongs he never committed. We invited you to repent. Have you repented of your sins and put your trust in Jesus alone for your salvation? Today can be your day to give your life to Jesus. In fact, there is no better day. Jesus said in Romans 10, 9 through 10, because if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For with the heart one believes and is justified, and with the mouth one confesses and is saved. That's repentance. That's turning from darkness to light, from bondage to freedom, from death to life, all because of Jesus. We invited you to remember. If you made the decision to repent and turn to Jesus today or on a day in the past, we provided the opportunity for you to remember the Lord Jesus Christ through communion, to remember your life before putting your faith in Jesus Christ, to remember the sin God saved you from, to remember and thank God for the new life you have in him because of the sacrifice of Jesus Christ. And now I'm inviting you to respond. What will you do with these days between now and Easter? What will you do with what you know about Jesus? Will you put your complete faith in him alone? Will you trust him? In responding, the reflecting doesn't end. Make time in your schedule to think over the journey to the cross that Jesus made. Recount the story by reading through the account in the Gospels. In response, you could also write out a prayer of thanks for what Christ has done. Or maybe as an artistic response, you could also write a poem or draw or paint. Jesus himself, upon his resurrection, gives the greatest instruction to respond, to go and respond to the gospel message. He says, and go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Will you tell someone who does not know Jesus about him? Who is the one person that comes to your mind that has not responded to the hope of salvation? Pray for that person to be ready for your text or your phone call. Pray that God would give you courage to invite that person to join you in person or online for Easter. Pray for their salvation. what will these next 3 days look like for you? I want us to listen to the words of this song as we close the service and meditate on what your response will be as we leave in silence and return on Sunday to rejoice.
You broke the bread and blessed the cup. You served a sacrifice of love. Holy, holy, holy. I wanna see the glory and all that you are and all that you've done. Jesus, the Lamb of God, oh, what a Savior. You took the altar.